Good morning. Turn to the open door. So glad you're with us today. Let's go ahead and just take a minute and pray. You can invite the Holy Spirit into your house, wherever you are. Lord, we just say welcome. We're not gathered together, but Lord, we are gathered in your name and you are with us. And we say, Holy Spirit, just have your way today. Come and do what you want to do in our homes, in our lives, in our families. We need you, Lord. Come in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
someone on your couch or in the dining room, go ahead and turn to them and say, "You're looking really good this morning." I bet it'll boost their day and make them feel better. We love you guys. We miss you. Can't wait till we can get back together. You know, we're still asking and believing that God's going to restore this nation. And we're also asking and believing, God, for some of you that may have seen a downturn in your finances. You know, the Lord tells us in Romans 10, he says that the word of God is near you. He says it's even in your mouth and in your heart. He said that word of faith. And I just want to speak a word over you this morning that whatever you're dealing with, it seems like a downturn, that God's going to restore to you. Amen. This morning, don't forget to give. You know, we've got three different ways that we're asking that you can give. You can give online. It's on the screen behind me. You can give snail mail, or you can drive up and drop in our secure box, which is, if you're looking at our front door, it's to the left on the door, and it's a secure drop box. Let me pray for you this morning. Jesus, thank you so much that we are a giving church, that we're a giving people. And Lord, I just want to pray over those that have seen a downturn in their finances. And it just seems like that they haven't had work to do. But God, you're going to restore all that the enemy has taken. Lord, you're going to restore to your people bountiful blessings. We're trusting you, Lord. We're believing you, Lord. We love you, Jesus. Be glorified in everything we say and do this morning. Amen.
We're used to singing this corporately together, fill this place. But I want you, as we sing this song, to just declare this over your house today, yes, over your apartment, wherever you're watching, yes, that you would just declare, "Lord, come and fill this place."
There is a
enter in to the presence of our great and mighty God. And certainly, if we look at things around us, we might feel discouraged, but there's something about when we turn our gaze and fix it on Jesus. How funny it is that our perspective changes. Because the things around us seem so minimal when we can see the greatness of our God. Oh, we worship you, Lord. We thank you, God, that you are in control. That you are sovereign. That you're a God who redeems us from death and pulls us into life. And we thank you, Jesus, for your great gift of sacrifice to us, Lord. Oh, if it wasn't for you, we'd be broken.
Chase me down with Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that's within me. Bless his holy name. Thank you, Lord, for your gracious presence. Your word declares a commandment, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. We will be those who worship and praise and extol you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Maybe in the part of your day, of whenever that is, you say, I don't have right words to praise God with. You can open Israel's songbook, the book of Psalms. Maybe you turn over to Psalms 100, or what I just quoted part of, Psalms 103, Psalms 150. And whether you say it or you sing it, go ahead and feel free to use those words from God's word and declare who he is as we make those choices. I'm so glad that you're here with us this morning. Thank you, worship team. And my heart is lifted up in worship. As Mary Helen already said, it's a change of our perspective when we have our focus back on the Lord. Those other things exist in our reality world, but there's a greater reality. So faith is not a denial of reality. It's a declaration of who God is. Hallelujah. I got a word this morning that I really felt so impressed of the Lord that I was to bring today. And let me give you a little running start at this. A lot of the experiences of people and of events that are recorded in the Bible, they serve really as illustrated messages for us. And they may serve as either some warning, some of them are positive examples for us, others can actually bring us revelation of spiritual truths. So what I believe the Lord would have us to learn from this morning is an experience that the Apostle Paul actually went through, which is recorded with such great detail, it takes an entire chapter of the Bible. Actually, the book of Acts, and it seems so applicable for us in the challenges of the multi-level storms that we're going through right now in 2020. The title of the message is How to Go Through a Storm Successfully. How to Go Through a Storm Successfully. Again, this storm story revolves primarily around the Apostle Paul, although he is by no means alone in this storm. You can go ahead and open your Bible, find your Bible, in your Bible, Acts chapter 27. We will most of the time be in that chapter of the Bible this morning. What I'd like for you to do, if you're not a note taker, become one this morning. Just jot down a few notes and see what God will speak to you, maybe even later on in the week through those things. I believe there are some principles that are found in Paul's experience that are going to help us this morning, and I want to share four principles. Now, I do not want us to mistake principles for some sort of formula, because a formula is like, if I follow this recipe, this is the way it works out. I'm not a cook. I'm an eater. I'm on the consumer end of that culinary business. But my understanding is that if you follow the recipe, each time you should get the same result. Sometimes people view the word of God that way and they say, well, if I pull this lever and I push this button and I say in Jesus' name, then it's always going to work out this way. No, wait a minute. So we're going to look at this morning is not a recipe or a formula, but there are four principles that I think will have influence on us in going forward, even through storms. Let me give you this example from another storm story that we looked at a few weeks ago. We spoke about Jesus and the disciples being caught in a terrible storm on the Sea of Galilee. And yet we saw that in that storm, Jesus stood and spoke, "Peace, be still." And the wind and the waves ceased. Now there's a powerful principle of the power of God to bring us to the other side of the storm. There's a powerful principle of the sustaining presence of Jesus in the midst of the storm. But in case maybe you've been speaking to your storm and it hasn't subsided, take heart and don't be discouraged, child of God. For that's not the only storm survival strategy that's found in the Bible. And don't get caught up in these common lies of the enemy. You just don't have enough faith, or God's mad at you, or God doesn't care. That's why your storm hasn't ended yet. You might as well give up. You may hear things like that of the enemy and of our own mind that would bring those things to us. Listen, we don't want to entertain the devil's messages anymore, his accusation. Can I say that takes fake news to a whole new level? Don't listen to the devil's reports those ways. Paul's storm that we're about to examine, it's unlike Jesus and the disciples because it was not over in just a moment either. And both the process and the outcome of this storm is different than the one with Jesus and his disciples. Yet God was still present and moving. So here's the backdrop. Because of Paul's boldness in speaking the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ, as he shared the gospel to both Jew and Gentile, or non-Jews, many of us, he created a lot of enemies in that process. Actually, the Jews were so opposed to them, they actually had a pact and were seeking to kill Paul. And in their plotting, they actually involved some Roman government officials as well. Now, let me just toss in a side note here. Just because some people oppose you, even in high positions, doesn't necessarily mean that you're wrong. Actually, you can tell a lot about a person by who has identified themselves as their enemies. See, if people who oppose righteousness and oppose God also oppose us, we're probably on the right path. So Paul, as he's been railroaded by a political system, a court system, then he finally exercises his legal rights as a Roman citizen. And he appeals his case to what is the equivalent of our Supreme Court. He said, "I appeal to Caesar," in this certain process. Now that's the backdrop of as we'll get into Acts chapter 27. So Paul is still being held captive or held in Roman custody. And he's being about to be transported to Rome by ship. At least that was the intention, along with some other Roman prisoners. So you can get a realistic idea about the size of this ship that he was in and all those things. There were some 276 men on board. We'll see the ship that Paul is traveling in. Let me summarize the first 8 or 9 verses of that chapter. We see the ship on which Paul is traveling, making several stops and going through several delays. And this first principle that I want us to look at together about going through storms successfully is realizing, number one, some storms are unavoidable. Some storms are unavoidable. But God apparently had given Paul an insight concerning the impending storm that would be in his immediate future. Let's begin with Acts chapter 27, the last part of verse 9. So Paul warned them, saying, "Men, I perceive that this voyage will end with disaster and much loss, not only of the cargo and ship, but also of our lives." Let me go back and define one word, that word perceive there. It's an insightful word from the original language. Men, I discern. Men, I see that God lets us sometimes see some things in the spirit. See, the Bible says that one of the works of the Holy Spirit is he'll show us things to come. The Holy Spirit was revealing something there. Paul tried to relay that to those that were in charge of that ship. Actually, in this case, see, Paul had a voice, but he didn't have the authority to change anything as far as what that ship was going to be set out to do. When we have the authority, though, there are many situations that we do have the authority in. Just settle this. When God says no, don't go. That's not rocket science. When God says no, don't go. For example, if the Bible says something is sin, it's wrong, it's against the will of God, don't pray about it. Don't ponder it. Don't consider it. Don't try to rationalize our way around it. Just settle. God said no, and I'm not going that way. Perhaps it's the pull of a temptation toward dishonesty. God said, no, don't go there. Maybe it's a pull toward sexual immorality, or maybe it's the more quiet pull of holding on to unforgiveness, that offense. If we're going there, we had better perceive that there is a serious storm brewing in our future if we choose a path of rebellion against God. I've been there. Listen to the voice of experience. It's a bad idea. If God says no, don't go. But again, in this situation with the Apostle Paul, he was not the one in authority over the ship. Let's look at verse 11. But the officer in charge of the prisoners listened more to the ship's captain and the owner than to Paul. That's important. The captain, the officer in charge of the prisoners, listened more to the ship's captain and the owner than to Paul. Somebody said this, who you give your ear to, you give your future to. We're going to listen to what the Word of God says, what the Holy Spirit says, or we're going to listen to other voices that would be contrary to that. Well, Paul's voice was ignored. And all of these people would eventually understand Paul was absolutely correct in what he was instructing them to do, or what he was foreseeing, perceiving. Decisions that you and I make when we are facing a storm, they're really important. See, in our current crisis in our country, I really want to encourage us as people of God, pray, continue to pray for President Trump, for Vice President Mike Pence, and for others in national authority, for Governor Greg Abbott and other Texas government leaders, and for our county leaders and city leaders. See, for those people have some authority here. It's our part, our biblical obligation to pray. God, give them ears to hear what's the right direction for our country. Every part of this, in Jesus' name. See, after those in charge of the ship had ignored Paul's warning, because even though, again, they heard his voice, they didn't respond positively to it. They set sail anyway with Paul and the other prisoners and the other people aboard. As soon as they did that, it's a hurricane, what we would call a hurricane or a typhoon hit, and it drove them out to sea. Actually, verse 15 words it this way. The sailors couldn't turn the ship into the wind, so they gave up and let it run before the gale, the hurricane. Again, reminding you, Paul was not in this storm because of his own wrong decisions. But there's a lesson still that we can learn here. When we do have the choice, listen, be guarded as to who we get in the boat with. The decision is ours, be guarded as to who we get in the boat with. I think I'm talking right now to some singles. I may be talking to some youth. About friends that you're getting in the boat with. Maybe I'm talking to some business people who get in alliance with some that you don't need to get in that boat. Maybe I'm talking to husbands and wives. Make sure that we all understand this. Not every boat is heading in a direction that God wants you to go. Now, for me, I'm all for storm avoidance when possible. But when we can't avoid it, we better know some godly principles about going through those storms successfully. Paul was in this storm, not of his own choosing, but going there, look at the principles that we'll find. Verse 18, let's go on and look at the situation as it exists, where we are in this experience. The next day, as gale-force winds continued to batter the ship, the crew began throwing the cargo overboard. The following day, they even took some of the ship's gear and threw it overboard. The terrible storm raged for many days, blotting out the sun and the stars. We saw that first. Look at the second principle for going through a storm successfully. Number two is storms can provide us opportunity to evaluate what is truly important. That's what's going on even now. Even in our land, this in the COVID-19 storm, the shelter in place, work from home, or maybe some have been laid off from their jobs they have. What we're seeing is that some of the cargo that we had accumulated in our lives needs to be thrown overboard. I found some baggage just needs to go. The systems that have so changed, you can't go out every night. You can't go to a restaurant and eat there, movies, shopping, sporting events. I know some things have really gotten tough for some there. I'm pretty sure a few weeks ago on ESPN, I saw marble races. I am serious, marble races. I know that set some of you upside down, but I couldn't believe it. But in this storm, maybe I need to let the Lord show me what's really important and what really isn't. Some people are actually pulling together in family time. In our house, I think I've seen more game playing, cards with grandkids, all these things, spending time in the Bible and intentional worship. I see people meeting and groups meeting and in Zoom meetings, leaders and youth and kids being receiving the word and encouragement in different ways. Remember in the storm, they actually threw out, it says in this storm, they threw out some of the ship's tackle, some of the gear. During our current storm, maybe I need to look at more what even things that I thought were essential to the ship going forward, the tackle of the ship. Maybe I need to look, it was just maybe added weight and distraction that needed to be tossed overboard anyway. Right where you said, could you give me one amen? Amen. All right, I took it. And look, it was a real practical thing for the sailors to do in this situation of the storm. For the storm was a good time to lighten the load. It's important when life becomes more normal, returns to that. Would we be careful about what we let back on board our ships? Because those things that God's revealing and prioritizing those things, let's be careful about those things that we let crowd out. What God is saying, this matters to me. While I'm on the subject, as father in this house, a spiritual father in this house, can I just address one more practical thing here? This week, or maybe in the next week or two, you're gonna get stimulus money deposited into your account. But instead of lightening your load, you're thinking about going out and getting a bigger TV or some other toys. Let me give you again some fatherly advice. Don't do that. Instead, pay your bills. Put some money back if you can. Maybe help somebody else in need if God's prompting you that way. Amen. Look back at Paul's storm. Let me share this third principle for going through a storm successfully. Number three is, even when despair is all around, keep seeking God. When your environment, when every person that you see in your immediate proximity may be in a despair and despondency mode, you keep seeking God. Look at this incredible experience again, modeled by the Apostle Paul. And as this scripture we'll look at in just a moment, it says so much about the morale of the men on the ship. Apparently, even including some other believers that were on the ship. Verse 20, it said, when neither sun nor stars appeared for many days, and the storm continued raging, we finally, listen, gave up all hope of being saved. It wasn't just the intensity of the storm, but it was the length of the storm that was bearing upon them. Ever been there? You say, I'm there right now. I understand. After many days, it said, we finally gave up all hope. Now, let me give you one side note that I think it's significant to me as we get this picture. Many of you know that the writer of the book of Acts was Luke, Dr. Luke, the same one who penned the gospel that bears his name. And it seems like he is probably accompanying Paul even at this time on the ship, because he's writing this in the first person. He says, we finally gave up all hope of being saved. But while the storm raged and the people were giving up, Paul had been involved in an activity that was beyond mere hand-wringing. Don't get stuck there. You can have moments, but boy, don't settle down and live in those kind of hand-wringing moments. But because apparently Paul had separated himself from the others at that point. And Paul was having his own prayer meeting. Maybe he heard that shelter in place order and he thought, I got no better place to shelter than under the wings of the Most High God. But he did. He made a decision about that. And I believe that Paul, from the history, the record here, he prayed. I believe he fasted. He obviously was listening to what God wanted him to hear. Look at the scriptural narrative again. Verse 21. No one had eaten for a long time. Finally, Paul called the crew together and said, "Men, you should have listened to me in the first place." Let me just pause there a second. That's not a model that I want you to embrace as a normal practice. I told you so. Some of us are already pretty practiced at that. It didn't go right. I told you so. But Paul didn't stop there. He goes on and even he said, you should have listened in the first place and not left Crete. You would have avoided all this damage and loss. But look at verse 22. He keeps talking. But take courage. None of you will lose your lives, even though the ship will go down. For last night, an angel of the God to whom I belong and whom I serve stood beside me. I love this declaration that Paul makes. And he's speaking to both believers and unbelievers at this point. And he said, this God to whom I belong, I know who owns me. Glory to God. In the storm, we need to know who we belong to. I'm not as an orphan abandoned, but God's watching over the God to whom I belong. And then he said, and the God whom I serve. My response to his lordship is we're to be serving him. And he said, the angel of God stood by me. And he said, verse 24, don't be afraid, Paul, for you will surely stand trial before Caesar. You're going to Rome. Reaffirmed a prophetic word. We'll not go there this morning, but you can go all the way back to Acts chapter 23, where Jesus himself spoke to Paul and said he would testify of Jesus at Rome also. Maybe Paul remembered not only that word that Jesus spoke to him, maybe he remembered his exhortation to young Timothy. In 1 Timothy 1 verse 18, Paul said, Timothy, my son, I'm giving you this command in keeping with the prophecies once made about you, so that, hear this, by recalling them, you may fight the battle well. Listen, some of you had prophetic words over you. You read scripture and it became a rhema word to you. You knew it was God speaking to you. I'm telling you, don't let go of those prophetic words in a time of storm. When God said, I've got a destiny for you, don't abandon that and let hopelessness come in like was affecting those around Paul. Paul continuing in that one more verse to Timothy, he said that you may, recalling those prophetic words over you, that you may fight the battle well, holding on to faith and a good conscience. That's the serving part of serving God. And a good conscience, which some have rejected and so have suffered, shipwreck with regard to the faith. Again, hold on to what God has spoken over you already. The angel reminded Paul on that ship, in that storm, you're going to Rome. Even though the GPS, the radar that Paul had pulled up on his smartphone surely said the storm, I'm in the middle of it still. We don't need a GPS to tell us that at this point. Listen, know this, so a storm doesn't negate God's plan for us if we won't quit following him. A storm does not negate God's plan for us if we won't stop following him. Would you just say this out loud with me? I choose to follow God's plan for my life. That's what you're declaring. That's what I'm declaring. Let me share one more principle for going through a storm successfully. This last principle, number four, is keep showing care for others in the storm with you. Keep showing care for others who are in the storm with you. Look at the next verse of Acts 27. This is verse 24. The angel had said, don't be afraid, Paul, for for you will surely stand trial before Caesar. What's more, God in his goodness has granted safety to everyone sailing with you. Verse 25, so take courage. He says that phrase again. So take courage. Look, for I believe God, it will be just as he said. I believe God. I believe God. It's going to be like he said. So even in this storm, Paul proclaiming his testimony and encouraging them. Let me just say this, child of God. Maintain your testimony in your storm. There's other folks that are looking at you. Paul didn't come up in a panic. He came up in a peace. Somebody said that people would try to draw you into their fear. Rather than that, let you draw them into your faith. And God would walk forward as he was doing with Paul. But this is important, the maintaining our testimony and just our lifestyles too. See, if I live as an angry person, if I keep a bad attitude, if I am a grumbler and complainer, if I am unloving and unkind and rude, and then I need to stand and say, listen, the angel of the Lord spoke to me. People are probably thinking, so what? Sure, who cares? We know how you act. Listen, Paul had been building his testimony and God doing that in him, and people were listening when he spoke. May God give us that sort of platform out of reflecting who he is in our everyday life. Let me touch on one other thing in the story, because I've read this passage so many times, this storm event. I've preached on it a number of times, but I've not seen this until studying this week. It's really something I just noticed. Actually, it's something that is absent from this story. It's not mentioned in any of this story here that Paul felt it was necessary to understand the deep origins of the storm. It doesn't say the storm was God's judgment against the sailors. It doesn't say the storm was the devil's attack against Christians on the ship. It doesn't even say here the storm was just the chaotic nature of a fallen creation, although that's what I believe may have been the case. But still, God would use the Apostle Paul in the storm and beyond the storm. Let me make application real quickly. In our COVID-19 storm, some people have tried to analyze and categorize this storm. And I'm telling you, we don't have to have all of that information for God to use us in the storm. Is that the judgment of God? Is this an attack of the devil? Is this a result of a fallen, sin-cursed creation? Maybe it's one of those three things or areas of combinations. But rather than us get disfocused in our storm, let's focus on what really does matter. God had let Paul know. He let him know that none of the people on the ship with him were going to die. None would be lost. What matters in our storm, we can, without knowing all the origin things of that, the deep-rooted things, understand that the will of God, the scripture declares it's his will that no one be ultimately lost. 2 Peter 3, verse 9, the last part of that verse is, God not willing that any should perish, but that how many? That all should come to repentance. Even after Paul had gotten the revelation from God about the safety of each man, that none of the 276 people on board that ship would die. And Paul had declared, I believe God, but I want you to understand something. Still, the storm raged on. It didn't end at that point. God didn't instruct Paul to step to the bow of the ship and say, peace be still. And the storm laid low at that point. No, it continued. But Paul was walking on in faith as the storm raged on. Paul had already told the rest of what the angel said to them. But let's read it, verse 26. He said, but we will be shipwrecked on an island. And then verse 27, so about midnight on the 14th night of the storm, calculate that, 2 weeks in the severe storm that was life-threatening. He said, as we were being driven across the Sea of Adria, the sailors sensed land was near. The ship continued on. Verse 41, let's skip through some stuff. They hit a shoal, a reef, and ran the ship aground too soon. The bow of the ship stuck fast while the stern was repeatedly smashed by the force of the waves, and it began to break apart. The soldiers wanted to kill the prisoners to make sure they didn't swim ashore and escape. Verse 43, but the commanding officer wanted to spare Paul, so he didn't let them carry out their plan. Then he ordered all who could swim to jump overboard first and make for land. The others held on to planks or debris from the broken ship. Was God faithful in the storm? Yes, he was. But rather than it just ceasing and going back to what was a normal sea, it was more like grab a board. Help somebody else find a board to float on, because God was still going to be true to his word. Child of God, God is always going to be faithful to his word. See, even if God's provision looks different than you were planning on. I think we'll just cruise into the bay of an island and kind of take a little break. No, they got stuck. The ship broke up. God still provided what they needed at that time. Look at verse 44 again for the rest of the verse. The others held on to planks and debris from the broken ship, so everyone, hear it, everyone escaped safely to shore. Yes, things were different after the storm, but God's process for Paul continued beyond that storm event. If we'll follow God, keep following him, his process continues for us too. Remember the word of the Lord that was spoken and affirmed to Paul, you're going to Rome. Paul, beyond the unanswered questions you may have, you're going to Rome. Can I say, beyond the Paul's question, and maybe he said, God, what about the shipwreck? But I want to, before I get there, let me just encourage you, child of God, with this. Keep pressing forward in what we know to be the will of God. Storm, broken ship, pieces floating, everybody drenched, cold, getting to shore, and yet we are to keep pressing forward in what we know to be the storm. Maybe Paul's questions, God, I don't even know what island we're being tossed on. When he gets on the island, we won't go there this morning with scripture, but you can read it in the Acts chapter 28. As they're gathering sticks, wet, soaking wet, exhausted, getting after 2 weeks and this hurricane force wind and the shipwreck and all of this, then they're building a fire. And out of the, as the fire starts, and Paul is one of the ones gathering sticks, there a snake comes up out of the fire and bites it, hangs onto his hand. It's a viper. They say that a viper that normally if someone's bit by it, takes one or two steps and falls over dead. You think Paul might have had any unanswered questions about that time? I do. God, what about all this? The Bible says he shook the snake off in the fire and kept on going. Some things that try to attach to you in or beyond the storm, shake them off in the fire of God and let's go on. Let's keep moving on. For you, it may be, I've got to close. For you, it may not be about the storms that you survived. Maybe it's the storms that were marked with failure. What if you look back and you said, well, I didn't do so good. I wasn't like Paul. I failed in my storm. So what about the backsliding? What about the divorce? What about the relapse it was going back to? What about stupid decisions that we made in a time of pressure and storm? This week, I was thinking about a certain man here, and I won't call his name at all, but his history had been in areas of addiction and things, but God had rescued him. wind up in a hospital, and this wasn't a teenager, a young man closer to my age is where he actually is. Through the course of bad decisions and failures, he found his way back to God and started walking in the things of God. But then after a period of time, a trap gets set. Look out for traps. Again, association opened up and alcohol entered the picture. And out of that became, a turn in that storm that was created through bad decisions. He was headed down a wrong path. But God was reminding me of this week, and it's probably been close to a year ago. And the relapse had happened, the failure had happened, and the weight of all of that. But some way, he wound up back in this church. I believe it was on a Sunday night. Sat back there near the back row. Somebody reached out as the service was just about over. He sat by himself. As the service was about over, somebody had gone back. Another man had gone back and began to reach out in the love of God to this man. And one other brother that was close just went. And you know, he that night began, out of that storm and out of that shipwreck of his own faith, that night was a turnaround point. See, what I didn't realize as he was prayed for, he had a bus ticket in his pocket already purchased to take him right back to the city where he had had the depths of junk in his life. He already had it bought to leave, but instead God interrupted his plan to run and grab him. I'm telling you, the love of God, even if you face failures and disasters of your own choices, or maybe by others' choices, don't stop in failure. Don't stop in backsliding. Don't stop short of returning to God. What I watched in that man, like that night, he took that bus ticket, paid for a bus ticket out of his pocket. He tore it up. Not going back. Some of you need to blow up the bridges to going back. I believe it was Johnny Moffitt who would say, if you're not, be aware that the sins of our past will rise up to comfort us. See, in a storm, the sins of our past, they look, oh, I remember how that felt, or that was, and the retouched photographs are not a true picture, but the enemy tries to lure you back into that with comfort. But I know of that man tearing up his ticket that night, and now many months, this almost a year, I think, has passed, and he has been pursuing God. If I want to look at somebody that's going to worship God, it'll be that man. Walking on in the things of God, the freedom, the liberty of God, and the purpose of God, because now he's spending his time, part of it, in reaching out to others to rescue them from the path that he had been in himself. Listen, what I just want to say is, what about you today? The storms, the failures. Remember, God's will is that not one would perish. It's your decision. Nobody can make that part of the decision for us. It's ourselves. It's not that somebody else is owning your ship. You have the authority there to say yes to Jesus or to say no. In Revelation chapter 3, Jesus speaking to an entire church. I believe it was the church at Ephesus, but he said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone will hear my voice and open the door," Jesus said, "I'll come in and fellowship." Listen, the Bible says that if we allow Jesus to come in, 2 Corinthians 5:17, if anyone is in Christ, they're a new creation. That word means an original formation, something that never was before. If anyone's in Christ, they're a new creation. The old has gone and the new has come. This day, I implore you, if you've been running from God, never had a relationship with God, receive Jesus today. You can pray very simply, but it's out of your heart. God, I come to you as a sinner. I confess that to you. You already know it. But I know that Jesus died for my sins. He paid that price. So I ask you on that basis, forgive me for my sins, for everything I've done wrong. Wash me and make me new like your word says you will. I open the door of my heart, and Jesus, I give you authority. Sit on the throne of my life, and I choose from this day forward by your power to let you be in charge. I confess you as my Lord, my owner, and my Savior in Jesus' name. Listen, if you one that's just run from God, and even in the midst of the storm, you found yourself sinking in that. When Peter started sinking after walking toward Jesus, got his eyes on all the other stuff around him, it wasn't some elaborate theological sounding prayer. He said, Lord, save me. And the Bible says that Jesus reached out his hand and took him. And today, even if you've just found yourself going down, let's call out to him, Lord, save me. Spirit, soul, and body, lift us up, oh God. Thank you for your very power. Worship team, I want you to come back and close us. And you go ahead and stay in the presence of God. You made that decision. We're going to close in this one song, and I'll come back and pray at the end of that. Bless the name of Jesus. Your glorious power, Lord.
Hallelujah. You are who you say you are.
Yes.
You'll do what you say you'll do.
That's right.
You'll be who you've always been to us, Jesus. Our hope is in you alone.
See where you find strength.
Our strength in your mighty name.
Oh, here's your peace. My peace.
My
unfailing, and we thank you for your consistent love, your overarching power and presence. Thank you, Lord, for your peace release, those that made decisions to follow you today. Thank you, Lord, for sustaining them in this forward movement, walking on into your plans and purposes. For every child of God, thank you for the refreshing of the presence of God. Every home, every single man and woman, every youth, every child, in the name of Jesus, for your order, your peace to come, in Jesus' name. And listen, if we can help you, follow up materials that we want to get to you, send an email to info@opendoorwaco.org. The church office is open if you want to call us, but I mean open through the normal office hours of the week. Feel free to do that too. We want to reach back to you. We trust that within a short period of time, I don't know the definite dates or anything yet, that we can come back together corporately. If it's a delay much time, I'm planning on us having parking lot services again, drive-in church, but I'm looking for better than that. God bless you. We love you. Go in peace in the grace of God.